Our speaker graduated from the College of Veterinary Medicine in De La Salle Araneta University in 2006, also taking up his master's degree in animal nutrition. His various work experience ranges from being a farm and extension veterinarian, being a technical sales representative for various veterinary drug companies, handling key accounts, up to handling technical and managerial positions specifically on the poultry sector. He has fully equipped himself by attending numerous conferences here and abroad, including the American Veterinary Medical Association Conference and the European Poultry Conference. Now he is connected with HIPRA Philippines Incorporated as a technical manager for companion animals, and at the same time, owner and proprietor of Tolentino's Animal Clinic and Grooming Center. With great pride, I'd like to introduce Dr. Joel Tolentino with his topic on vaccination perception, review of immunology, diseases, and vaccine handling.
Hello, everyone. Good morning. In behalf of HIPRA Philippines, we would like to thank the Philippine Animal Hospital Association for giving us the time and opportunity to talk about a topic that is very, very close to my heart, or very, very close to the company's heart. So today, we will be talking about vaccination perception, review of immunology, diseases, and vaccine handling. So I'm Dr. Joel Tolentino. So I've been with the company for 10 years. I've handled the key accounts position and also the technical services for poultry. During the weekdays, I am a poultry practitioner. And then during the weekends, during the night, during my free time, I am just like you, a small animal practitioner or a companion animal practitioner. So I would like to share with you, before I start my presentation, I would like to share with you a quote na it's about learning about the basic. It's going back to the basic. Because I've been attending PBMA convention, a few of the PAHA convention, I've been seeing that most of the topics that were being talked about or being discussed was all about surgery, dentistry, numerous cases, tumor removal, and etc. So why not going back to the basic strengthens your foundation. So what I mean to say is that let's talk about vaccine, let's talk about diseases. Let's talk about the basic or standard procedures in the field of veterinary medicine. So are we ready to talk about immunology and diseases? So let's begin. Let's start with canine immunity. Going back in college, it's a 2 or 3 unit subject. It's a bit, let's say, lots of technical terminologies as far as I can remember. So you need to look in every detail of the dictionary in order for you to know what are the lymphocyte, what are the MHC that they are talking about, what are the abbreviation that they are talking about. But with my stint in the company, I think I'm a bit, let's say, know the basic of immunology. So as far as I remember, when we were in college, a bacteria, a virus or a fungi is composed of a protein, and the protein is an antigen. So once the antigen enters the body, your humoral immunity, your cellular immunity will be activated. So the B cell, the T cells will be there. And when we discuss about humoral immunity, it's a protection that's coming from the blood. So the antibodies will be active, the B cells will be active, the memory cells will be active. So this will help or this will strengthen our immune system. So humoral immunity, it's a longer protection. It's within your blood, it's within your serum. And when we discuss or talk about humoral immunity, it's about local immunity. If you have protection coming from your nose or the respiratory system, you have the protection. But usually when we discuss about cellular immunity, it's fast if you need the protection, but it's a bit, let's say, is lower in terms of the lifespan or in terms of the duration of protection. So cellular immunity, it's local immunity, protection from the respiratory system, digestive system, and maybe the urinary system. On the next slide, we will be discussing about innate or adaptive immunity. When we said about innate immunity, it's the protection coming from the skin. And if ever our skin or the mucous membrane cannot, let's say, protect ourselves, there will be an inflammation, there will be swelling. And then if, again, swelling will not be of help to our system, the third line of defense or the acquired immunity will come up. So the humoral immunity, the cellular immunity will be of great help to our body or to the animal's body. So humoral immunity, it's a longer protection. Cellular immunity, it's a local protection. Now, like what I've said, going back to the basic, let's know about the battle. Let's know about what's inside our vaccine, because our company, we're just new in the market. So we are a bit, I'm just fascinated with some of our colleagues asking, can I give the first shot to my dog or to my clients with live vaccine? And I was thinking, it's live vaccine we're giving in. So let's know how the duration of immunity happen and what's inside the vaccine, or how do we handle the vaccine in order for us to have a good vaccination response or to have a protection for our animals. Now let's differentiate. When we open our refrigerator in the clinic, we have two bottles that usually we get. One, the one that's containing the powder or the freeze-dried tablet, and then the other one, the liquid part. So let's differentiate it. The live vaccines, the live inactivated vaccine. So the freeze-dried tablet is the live, and then the inactivated vaccine is the liquid part. So in terms of the safety, or in, both of them are safe to give in. In terms of the economics, yes, the live vaccines are a bit cheaper. The inactivated vaccine is also cheaper because it's combined. But in swine and in the poultry industry, the inactivated vaccine are way expensive than your live vaccine. It's about 5 to 10 times expensive than your usual live vaccine. Mass application, yes, you can give live vaccine in mass application by the hundreds, by the millions, if ever. But for us in the small animal practice, we give it individually. For the rapid onset of immunity, for the live vaccine, depends on how you administer it. The live vaccine gives a fast onset of immunity or a fast protection. While if you give the killed vaccine, you give in at around, let's say, 2 to 4 weeks before it will have a protection. That's why sometimes we had some break sa clinic. We just vaccinated the dogs, and then after 2 to 3 days, the dogs become ill. The dog might have a break with carbo, distemper, or whatsoever, because our vaccine, because it's being combined, alive and killed, it acts as an inactivated vaccine. So the protection might be at 2 to 4 weeks before we can have a response or before we can have a protection with our pets. In terms of the combination, yes, you can buy it. There's a 5-in-1, 2-in-1, 7-in-1 vaccines. And interference of maternal antibodies, the live vaccine can interfere with the maternal antibodies because it is fast. It can elicit an immune response. So if ever you have high maternal antibodies, it will just neutralize the vaccine. So it will not have an effect. That's why all of us in the small animal practice, we are doing numerous vaccination administration in the dogs. Let's say 4, 5 times. Some of the clinics, they're doing it at 6 times. Just for them not to interfere with the maternal antibodies. The maternal antibodies in dog, based on study or references, it declines at around 6 weeks, 10 weeks, depending on the antibodies coming from the dam, or depends also on the, let's say, field challenge. Based on the references or the literature and based on science, we usually have, again, numerous way of administering vaccine, numerous times of administering vaccine in the animals. So we do it every 2 to 3 weeks. Other literature said 3 to 4 weeks, but usually let's do it in the middle. Let's do it at 2 to 3 weeks. The more you give, the more antibody response. During our time in college, it is always said that you need first exposure, and then once you decline, this will be the time that you need to administer the vaccine. So yes, it's right. Like on this graph, on the first decline, you need to administer the vaccine. And then on the next slide, as you can see, it's a bit slower. that the antibody declines. So you need to give at least 4 or 5 times the vaccine in order for you to elicit a good immune response. There are different types of vaccine that are given in dogs, but I think 20 or 30 years ago in the small animal practice, most of the vaccines are only live and killed. In the poultry segment, in the swine segment, there are different types of vaccine. There are what you call the purified subunit vaccine, the recombinant vaccine, and the DNA vaccine. But in the small animal practice, because the vaccination program is working, we are only using live and then the killed vaccine. So it's a modified and inactivated virus. The live virus or the live vaccine comprises of the canine parvovirus, distemper, the parainfluenza, the leptospirosis, the infectious laryngotracheitis, and then the inactivated vaccine comprises the leptospirosis, the rabies, and then the kennel cap, they are inactivated vaccine. So in our practice or in the companion animal segment, it's only the live and only the killed vaccines that are active. Now, let's talk about the storage and reconstitutional condition. So there are some literature saying that the optimum temperature or the right temperature in order for you to have a good storage of vaccine is around 2 to 7, 2 to 8 degrees, or you need to aim at 5 degrees Celsius. In our company or the company that I'm currently working right now, we have a segment or a program called Bantay Bakuna. So this segment is a way of checking our business partner, our dealer, on how they are storing the vaccine. In the small animal practice, usually there are numerous breeders, there are clients that enter the clinic and say, "Doc, I need to vaccinate my dogs. It's being vaccinated with these 2 shots, 2, 3 vaccines. But unfortunately, there's no signature, the veterinarian." So the technical term or the right term that you can answer to our client is that we really don't know. It's not about there's no signature about the veterinarian. Most of the vaccines work, but if ever you don't have the proper storage or the right handling with the vaccine, for sure, the vaccine will not work. The vaccine will fail. There are lots of break because of handling the vaccine. And then once you aspirate the vaccine, you need to inject it immediately. So how fast will I be injecting the vaccine that was being aspirated, specifically the live and then the killed one? We had a study about the stability of live vaccine and comparing it with the temperature. After 2 hours, at a room temperature of 20 degrees Celsius, 70% of the potency of the vaccine diminishes. So 70% na lang siya nag-work. While at 25 degrees Celsius, 50% of the vaccine works. While at 31 degrees or at room temperature, the vaccine dies. So based on literature, based on references, they said it's 1 hour. On a maximum, if ever you put it in the rep, you can still use it within 2 hours as long as it's cold. But after 2 hours, don't use it because it might fail. So the vaccine potency is a bit okay pa at 2 hours with the temperature of 20 degrees or a bit lower. So again, be reminded about the storage, the reconstitution, and the handling of your vaccines. Usually when we do our portion, the Bantay Bakuna, we've been seeing some poultry supply, some dealers that are putting the inactivated vaccines in the shelf. So they are not putting it in the refrigerator. Most of our vaccine break comes from an improper handling. Some of the workers in the farm of the assistant, they put the vaccines in the freezer. So as you can see, the vaccine might deteriorate, or of course the vaccine will not work. Also, please check about the cold chain support. Again, if ever there will be a break and you suspect a break with your vaccination storage or your vaccine handling, please refrain it from using it. I mean, you don't want to gamble the life of your pet. If ever there will be a break or you suspect there are lots of vaccine that are in store in your refrigerator and you suspected it to be to be, let's say, destroyed or damaged because of the temperature, you can do potency testing. I think our government can do potency testing, but you can do it just with a live vaccine. The inactivated vaccine, you cannot do it. So just be reminded about the optimum temperature at 2 to 8 degrees. Now, I've been observing some of our colleagues with what are the composition of the vaccines inside. So there are lots of vaccines, specifically the live vaccines, the DP, the DHLP, and the DHLPPY. So we just need to check about the composition, the specific indication or the recommendation of each manufacturer. When we talk about DP, it's distemper parvo, it's 2-in-1. You give it at week 6 up to week 8, just one shot, the initial shot. And when we hear about DHLP, it's a distemper, hepatitis, the leptospirosis, and then the parvovirus. While the DHLPPY are distemper, hepatitis, leptospirosis, parvovirus, and parainfluenza. Just be on the lookout lang with hepatitis, because hepatitis, you might be seeing laryngotracheitis in some of the indication recommendation of the vaccine company. It's just the same. It just so happened that they can cross-protect. Infectious laryngotracheitis and hepatitis in dog can cross-protect. But the one that is inside the vaccine is the infectious laryngotracheitis. And then parainfluenza is the kennel cough. But there are lots of, let's say, causative agent of kennel cough in dogs. And one is parainfluenza. Also, the method of administration. Now, we are just using subcutaneous injection, but I've been asking some senior veterinarians. They used to be give some respiratory vaccine, like the kennel cough vaccines intranasal before. I think it's 0.5 in each nose. You're doing it if ever you wanted the vaccine to elicit a faster immune response. Like what I've said, if it's local immunity, you can go fast, but the protection is a bit faster. So usually we are giving our vaccine subcutaneously. Before, I think I tried when I was a student, I tried giving it intramuscularly. So after two or three days, naglilimp yung dog. So I think it will be better pa rin subcutaneously. But based on literature or references, it is much better to give intramuscular injection in dogs because it can elicit a fast immune response. But again, limping is the usual post-vaccination reaction that we've seen. So better to do it subcutaneously, but we are giving it naman at least 4 or 5 times the vaccine. Number of doses, it's also a debate. If you will be recommending 3 shots of the 5-in-1, the 7-in-1 vaccine, some of our colleagues might think, oh, your vaccines are not that potent enough to give protection. And then if you will be giving it the longer or the many times, some of our colleagues might be thinking, why that many? Why not 4? Why not 5? Okay? I mean, this program is subject to individual situation of the animal and epidemiological situation in the area. So at least we as a veterinarian, we have clinical eye. Before, when I started my practice, small animals, 7 or 8 years ago, I only vaccinated 3 times. But I've been seeing numerous breaks of parvovirus. So when I did it at 5 times, there was no break. So it's up to the veterinarian on how many times will he be giving vaccines. But for me, at least 5 times, you give the vaccine and then annual revaccination. There's some debate about revaccination every 3 years. But I do ask some of our colleagues, what are you going to choose? Will it be science or will it be convenience? So most of the manufacturer, they are advising to give at least every year annual vaccination of the core vaccines for our small animal or our companion animal pets. Now, there are lots of factors about the duration of immunity. There's what you call the concurrent vaccination administration. There is also a debate, according to references, the more antigenic component, the more viral load that's inside the vaccine, the more PBR that will happen. So some of the vaccines are being reported to have post-vaccination reaction. So some of the suppliers, some of our colleagues are saying you can underdose, you can give it at least 0.8, 0.9. And then I'm shocked when I hear some that are saying remove the diluent or remove the inactivated vaccine. Just use the plain triple distilled water and then there will be no PBR. But again, there will be no protection with the inactivated part, which is the leptospirosis. So you need to assess. So if ever there's a vaccine that has, let's say, high incidence of PBR, it will be better to give the vaccine alone. Do not give it simultaneously with other vaccine. Most of the vaccine that are causing post-vaccination reaction are inactivated vaccine. Next, genetic background, some references. Literature said that Rottweilers are can easily be affected by parvovirus. So again, if you have Rottweilers, clients with Rottweilers, it will be better to have an aggressive vaccination program. The earlier, the better. Adjuvants for the killed vaccines. Of course, the age. So at least despite the age, despite the aging of the dogs, it will still be better if you give the vaccine every year. Once you give the vaccine, you just immunomodulate the dog. You just give vitamins, you just support it so that the vaccine will have a good intake in the body of our animals. Another steroid hormone, it can cause immunosuppression. Concurrent illness, what are you going to do? Will I treat the disease? Will I treat the tumor? Will I treat this before doing the vaccination? So for us, veterinarian, we can assess or let's say we can think, what is the priority? If ever there are lots of field infection in the area, for me, better to do vaccination. But if ever the area is a bit, let's say, quiet in terms of field challenge or field diseases, better to treat the disease first. And then also the stress. For us, still, it's a protocol for us that whenever there's a new puppy, a new arrival dog, we usually condition it for a week or 2 weeks before we vaccinate the animals. And again, the immunosuppressive drug, because it causes immunosuppression, specifically the steroid drug. Now, what will happen if we have a vaccination failure? Am I going to call the supplier and tell them that your vaccine doesn't work? No, we need to investigate what happened. So vaccination, if ever you have a correct administration, of course, the animal will respond. But if ever you will have an incorrect administration, the inappropriate route, a death of the live vaccine, and then you might be giving it too early. The maternal antibodies are high, of course, there will be no effect of the vaccine. But usually, the initial reaction, if ever we have a vaccination failure, is that there's a disease. The animal, if ever we suspect it as a PBR, sometimes there are lump at the back of the animal. And then I've been seeing some post-vaccination reaction like chilling, some animals faint. So what we can do as a practitioner is just to let our clients wait, let's say 10 to 15 minutes, you massage the back, you give the animal air, at least malamig, in order for the animals to cope up or to wake up. And then, reason also why the animal failed to respond is that the animal might be immunosuppressed. I've seen this once, but never before na it was repeated. Immunosuppressed, the animal always has a fever. And then I think the animal started to degenerate na rin. And then biological variation is what the vaccine, what's the vaccine? What's the strain or the serotype of the vaccine that's inside? And then a few vaccine that you are giving your animals. So there are lots of vaccination failure or vaccination break that might happen. So what are the preventable diseases with the vaccines? So according to Wasaba, so as a review again, we have the core and then the non-core vaccines. We are doing it every day in our practice. We have the core, the parvo, the distemper, the adenovirus, the leptospirosis, and then the rabies. And then the non-core vaccine, it depends if you will be giving it or not. If you've seen some case of kennel cap, you can give an additional parainfluenza. If you are suspecting it Bordetella or coronavirus, you can give it. But again, these are non-core vaccine. What are priority are the core vaccines. So now, let's talk about the diseases. Canine parvovirus, a disease very, very favorite of ours. We've been observing it during the rainy season or during Christmas, but nowadays we are observing it the whole year round. Once you have a new puppy, of course, you will have a disease of parvovirus. There are different variants, but specifically the one that's causing diseases sa dog is yung CPB-2A, CPB-2B, and CPB-2C. I'm happy to share with you the presentation done by our colleagues. So I'm happy that there's a presentation with the companion animal or the small animal industry. So this is about genetic characterization and phylogenetic analysis done by Dr. Dennis O'Malley. So I ask his permission to have a screenshot of his presentation. So what he isolated was CPB2A and CPB2B, which is 99% identical with the ones that we've been seeing in Thailand and then in China. So there's a genetic evolution with canine parvovirus. Now, I think there's some debate or some references about the potent CPB2C that is being rampant in the US and now also in the US, and also rampant in Europe and also in the US. But based on studies, based on literature, current version of the vaccines, which is 2A and 2B, they are having a protection with 2C. And then when you do vaccination of type 2 CPB2, it can protect against CPB and CPB2C. So that means our vaccine, regardless of the strain, can protect against either CPB2B or CPB2C strain. So there's cross protection between the strain of the canine parvovirus. And also with the canine distemper, it's a neurologic virus, it's a neurologic disease. There are only a few hospitals or a few clinics that accepts confinement with this disease. Most of the clients, they will go on this clinic and they will pass by again to another clinic just to have a second opinion on how are they going to treat their dogs, specifically if there is a nervous signs of distemper. So we usually do antibiotic treatment for the secondary infection. We do fluid therapy. We manage the seizure and etc. But still, in order for you to prevent canine distemper, you need to vaccinate your dogs. And also, I'm happy to share with you again a study done by Dr. Dennis O'Malley. So I think this study was done on the 2017. So the prevalent, let's say, strain or species of canine distemper here in the Philippines is the one that resembles coming from the Thailand canine distemper. So I'm asking him if we can collaborate. I did not know that he already did the parvo and then the distemper genetic or molecular identification. Now, most of our colleagues, we are a bit confused with the CAB1 and CAB2. So most of the vaccines, it composed CAB2 or the canine adenovirus. Canine adenovirus or CAB2, it's the positive agent of infectious laryngitis or canine infectious laryngitis. And also, canine hepatitis is being cross-protected by the canine adenovirus type 2. So you might be confused, but most of the vaccines, they have CAB2 in it. This is just a study about the canine adenovirus. Before, they are putting CAB1 in the vaccine, but they are seeing bluish eye or a discoloration in the eye. That's why they remove it. They put CAB2 and then it can cross-protect. So they remove totally the canine hepatitis or the CAB2, CAB1 in the composition of the virus, of the vaccine. Now, in terms of the canine parainfluenza virus, it is one of the causative agent of canine. There are lots of pathogens that cause cough in our dogs. So namely, there's your Platella, there's your herpes virus, there's your influenza virus. But it's a group. For example, in swine, there is a PRDC or postoperatory disease complex. In the small animal practice, there's also the canine infectious respiratory disease complex. So you still need to vaccinate your dog with the parainfluenza virus. Now, when leptospirosis is concerned, there are not much data or study about the cross protection. So we usually give leptospirosis during the rainy season. Some clinics, they are doing a twice a year vaccination with leptospirosis. just for you to have, let's say, a peace of mind that my daughter infected bacteria. But there are lots of, let's say, zero type of leptospirosis or zero bars that are affecting. But mostly, all of the vaccines, they are composed of 2 or 4 vaccines. So in particularly, the canicula or icterohemorrhagica. Some say that the more you put or the more leptospirosis vaccine, the more post-vaccination reaction that you might see or you might observe in dogs. So like what I've said during my previous slide, if ever you will be seeing some post-vaccination reaction, specifically in giving higher doses of leptospirosis vaccine, you need to do it alone. Do not do it simultaneously with other vaccine. Now, in terms of the publication, our company did, let's say, 2 publications of so it's the antibody response against canine parvovirus of client-owned dog puppies after vaccination with bivalent or multivalent vaccines containing live mutated strain. So it was being done with 110 puppies at week 6 to week 8. It was being vaccinated with a 2-in-1 vaccine and some multivalent vaccine. The good thing about this study, most of the vaccine gives protection in our dogs. All of the vaccine gave a unique antibody, gave an antibody response. The good thing about giving the 2-in-1 vaccine, because there are only 2 in it, which is the distemper and then the parvovirus with higher dose of vaccine, it elicit a faster antibody response comparing with your, let's say, multi-doses or multi-doses vaccine. But still, the 2-in-1 and then the 5-in-1 or the 7-in-1 vaccine protects your dog. Another study is the reduction of canine leptospirosis disease and shedding by Leptospira bivalent vaccine following challenge in dogs. It was done in Colombia on 2018. So this is a challenge vaccination. The challenging part in doing challenge vaccination is that you need to have lots of permit in order for you to do a challenge vaccination. So this is an experiment done in 24 specific pathogen-free beagle. So they were vaccinated 3 times at 8, 12, and 16 weeks. And then at 20 weeks, they were being challenged with the icterohemorrhagica and canicula leptospirosis strain. So after 6 to 8 days, 2 of the dogs died. But we did not let them die with the disease. So when we saw the icteros, the thrombocytopenia, we euthanized the dog. In order for them, I mean mercy killing is done in order to achieve the regulation done by Internal Ethics Committee, because like what I've said, it's a bit challenging to do a challenge vaccination in small animal practice. But in conclusion, the vaccine works. Among the 12 dogs, SPF dogs that were vaccinated, all of them did not die. All of them lives, and then those that are on the control group, 2 of them died. Now, as a take-home message, I always said this to our colleagues, veterinarians, and business partner. In order for you to achieve a successful vaccination program, you need to have proper timing and good handling. That's the reason why we give 4 or 5 times this 5-in-1, this 7-in-1 vaccine, in order for us to time the decline of bacterial antibodies and in order for us to get the decline or the increase of the antibodies in the dog. And at the same time, good handling. If ever you did not give the optimum temperature, if you really don't know the proper storage of your vaccine, of course, the vaccination will fail. So remember the 2 factors that can be critical for a successful vaccination program. 1 would be timing, and then number 2 would be good handling. Again, in behalf of Hipra Philippines, we would like to thank the Philippine Animal Hospital Association for giving us the time and opportunity to talk about basic immunology, diseases, and vaccine handling. If ever you need some clarification or some question about my presentation or about the vaccine, please feel free to contact me. I'm Dr. Joel Tolentino. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. Good morning. Thank you very much for listening. Hope you're still awake. And I do impart some knowledge that can be of help in our everyday practice. So the floor is now open for the question and answer. And then one question is about what are the benefits and advantages of your vaccine compared to the existing vaccines in the market? I like the question. Okay. So I will be sharing you three advantages of the vaccine compared with other competitor. So we do manufacture our own vaccine. We are accredited with the EMEA group, which is the European, Middle East, and Africa organization. We own our own warehouse, laboratory, and facilities. The vaccine was already registered since 2009, but here in the Philippines, it's just registered last year. But there are lots of, let's say, clients that are using it. It has a flip top part on top of the bottle. So you are sure about the freshness of the vaccine. We are sure about the quality. And then number three, comparing it with other competitor, we have the highest parvo and distemper vaccine or viral load or TCID. Or the tissue culture infective dose, wherein the higher the TCID, the better for it to cross or break through high maternal antibodies in terms with parvo and distemper. Okay, so next question. If you pack 100 vials of canine vaccine, what's your recommended number of ice gel to be able to maintain the desired temperature? So just to review, the temperature must be at 2 to 8 degrees, or let's aim for 5. If you pack, let's say, 100 vials of canine vaccine, it will be dependent on the container that you will be using. For us, it is recommended to use a styro box, the better the styro box. And then if ever that you will just be packing, let's say, 100 vials, it will be better for 5 or 8 ice gel. You will use ice gel. Don't use the regular ice because it will drip and it has an inconsistent temperature. But for example, for us, if we are delivering vaccines going to Luzon, we are packing at least 10 ice gel. And then if ever we will be delivering vaccines in Visayas and Mindanao, we are putting, let's say, 15 ice gel. But again, we are putting some, let's say, plastic wrapping, some cartons or boxes inside or in between the ice gel or in between the vaccine in order for it to have, let's say, not to decrease the temperature. Just for example, the ice gel will come in contact directly with the vaccine. So at least if just a small, let's say a small amount or a small quantity of vaccine, 5 or 8 will do. But if it will be a long travel or a long delivery from clinic to other branches, maybe at around 10. Okay? So what is the recommended storage material for transport of vaccines? Do you allow Coleman and other plastic containers? Okay, like what I've said, better to use ice gel. So ice gel, we've tried, but it's just an internal, an internal experiment done in our warehouse. We sealed a styro container. We put ice gel at around 10 to 20 ice gel. We monitor the temperature after 2 days. So far, it's still okay. But that means that use ice gel for the consistent, let's say, 2 to 8 degrees temperature. If you are going to use Coleman if you will just be doing home service. if you will be delivering a small quantity of vaccines going to other branches, because Coleman, it has some small crevices, and sometimes the coldness, let's say, escape. So better to use a thick styro container and then seal it with a packaging tape or a tape so that the temperature will be sealed inside. So what we usually do, we have this thick styro boxes that has, let's say, the size is about 60 by 42 by 64 inches. So it's somewhat big container, thick styro, and then we usually seal it in order for it to have to maintain the optimum temperature for the vaccines. Next question, please. Is it necessary to have a temperature data logger every time you transport vaccines? Oh, good question. Okay. So we recommend the temperature data logger if you will be delivering vaccines for about, let's say, 2-3 days. If you will be delivering vaccines in less than 24 hours, it's not that economical to use data logger. So data logger is like a USB. So there are lots of data loggers now in the market. You can look at it in Shopee. The cost of the disposable data logger is about 600 pesos or up to 1,000 pesos. While the ones that you can reuse is about, I think, 6,000 pesos. Okay? The beauty or the good thing about data logger is you will know the consistent temperature. For example, if you will be delivering it 3 days or 2 or 3 days. But again, you need to change or replace the ice gel every, let's say, 24 hours just for you to be sure. But the data logger is just like a USB. Once it arrived the warehouse, once it arrived your facilities, you just get the data logger, you put it inside the computer, and then you will analyze it. There's the PDF format, the Excel format, wherein you can check if there was a break. There was a break during the cold chain or during the delivery. So the data logger is recommended during long haul flight, or if ever you will be shipping vaccines via sea. 24 hours or more, data logger is recommended. But if not, like what we are doing here in Luzon, we are just using the regular digital thermometer. We record the temperature as we go out of the warehouse. And then once it arrived, the clinic, the vaccine, or the farm, we read again the thermometer. So once it's okay, so the vaccine was accepted, or you can accept the vaccine. And also check the consistency of the gel, if it's still, solid. Okay, John. If the dog is between 8 to 12 months old, how many times do you need to vaccinate the dog with 5-in-1? Okay, good question. If the dog is at 8 to 12 months old, so at least it surpasses the critical stage of, let's say, 2 months up to 6 months. For me, based on experience, I still recommend to vaccinate at least three vaccines. So 5-in-1, you give it let's say every 2 to 3 weeks. At least three, you give the vaccine at 2 to 3 weeks. Okay. Again, in behalf of HIPAA Philippines, thank you very much for the Philippine Animal Hospital Association for giving us the time and opportunity to talk about a special topic. And then if ever, I think there are lots of questions, I will just be correlating it with the PAHA Secretariat. I will try to answer your queries or questions through email or through call. And if ever you need to communicate with us, specifically the products or some things that we can be of help, please feel free to check our website. So again, I'm Dr. Joel Tolentino. Thank you very much for your time, and more power in the small animal industry. Thank you.